Rudy's youth. In the end, she had to give it to him. He knew how to perform. A portrait of Rudy Steiner, July 1941. Strings of mud clench his face. His tie is a pendulum, long dead in its clock. His lemon, lamp-lit hair is disheveled, and he wears a sad, absurd smile. He stood a few meters from the step and spoke with great conviction, great joy. Alles ist scheiß, he announced. All is shit. In the first half of 1941, while Liesel went about the business of concealing Max Vandenberg, stealing newspapers and telling off mayors' wives, Rudy was enduring a new life of his own at the Hitler Youth. Since early February, he'd been returning from the meetings in a considerably worse state than he'd left in. On many of those return trips, Tommy Mueller was by his side in the same condition. The trouble had three elements to it. A triple-tiered problem. Tommy Mueller's ears, Franz Deutscher's the irate Hitler Youth leader, Ruth's inability to stay out of things. If only Tommy Mueller hadn't disappeared for 7 hours on one of the coldest days in Munich's history 6 years earlier. His ear infections and nerve damage were still contorting the marching pattern at the Hitler Youth, which I can assure you was not a positive thing. To begin with, the downward slide of momentum was gradual, but as the months progressed, Tommy was consistently gathering the ire of the Hitler Youth leaders, especially when it came to the marching. Remember Hitler's birthday the previous year? For some time, the ear infections were getting worse. They had reached the point where Tommy had genuine problems hearing. He could not make out the commands that were shouted at the group as they marched in line. It didn't matter if it was in the hall or outside, in the snow or the mud or the slits of rain. The goal was always to have everyone stop at the same time. One click, they were told. That's all the Freuer wants to hear. Everyone united, everyone together as one. Then Tommy. It was his left ear, I think. That was the most troublesome of the two, and when the bitter cry of halt wet the ears of everybody else, Tommy marched comically and obliviously on. He could transform a marching line into a dog's breakfast in the blink of an eye. On one particular Saturday at the beginning of July, just after 3:30, and a litany of Tommy-inspired failing marching attempts, Franz Deutscher, the ultimate name for the ultimate teenage Nazi, was completely fed up. Mueller, du off! His thick blonde hair massaged his head, and his words manipulated Tommy's face. You ape, what's wrong with you? Tommy slouched fearfully back, but his left cheek still managed to twitch in a manic, cheerful contortion. He appeared not only to be laughing with a triumphant smirk, but accepting the bucketing with glee. And Franz Deutscher wasn't having any of it. His pale eyes cooked him. Well, he asked, what can you say for yourself? Tommy's twitch only increased in both speed and depth. Are you mocking me? Heil, twitched Tommy in a desperate attempt to buy some approval, but he did not make it to the Hitler part. That was when Rudy stepped forward. He faced Franz Deutscher, looking up at him. He's got a problem, sir. I can see that. With his ears, Rudy finished. He can't... Right, that's it. Deutscher rubbed his hands together. Both of you, six laps off of the ground. They obeyed, but not fast enough. Schnell, his voice chased them. When the six laps were completed, they were given some drills of the run, drop, down, get up, get down again variety. And after 15 very long minutes, they were ordered to the ground for what should have been the last time. Rudy looked down. A warped circle of mud grinned up at him. What might you be looking at? It seemed to ask. Down, Franz ordered. Rudy naturally jumped over it and dropped to his stomach. Up, Franz smiled. One step back. They did it. Down. The message was clear, and now Rudy accepted it. He dived at the mud and held his breath, and at that moment, lying ear to sodden earth, the drill ended. Vielen Dank, mein Herren, Franz Deutscher politely said. Many thanks, my gentlemen. Rudy climbed to his knees, did some gardening in his ear, and looked across at Tommy. Tommy closed his eyes, and he twitched. When they returned to Himmel Street that day, Liesel was playing hopscotch from some of the younger kids, still in her BDM uniform. From the corner of her eye, she saw the two melancholic figures walking toward her. One of them called out. They met on the front steps of the Steiner's concrete shoebox of a house, and Rudy told her all about the day's episode. After 10 minutes, Liesel sat down. After 11 minutes, Tommy, who was sitting next to her, said, "It's all my fault." But Rudy waved him away, somewhere between sentence and smile, chopping a mud streak in half with his fingers. "It's my," Tommy tried again, but Rudy broke the sentence completely and pointed at him. "Tommy, please." There was a peculiar look of contentment on Rudy's face. Liesel had never seen someone so miserable, yet so wholeheartedly alive. Just sit there and twitch or something. And he continued with the story. He paced. He wrestled his tie. The words were flung at her, landing somewhere on the concrete step. "The Deutscher," he summed up buoyantly. "He got us, huh, Tommy?" Tommy nodded, twitched, and spoke, not necessarily in that order. It was because of me. Tommy, what did I say? When? Now! Just keep quiet! Sure, Rudy. When Tommy walked forlornly home a short while later, Rudy tried what appeared to be a masterful new tactic. Pity. On the step, he perused the mud that had dried as a crusty sheet on his uniform, then looked Liesel hopelessly in the face. What about it, Samench? What about what? You know. Liesel responded in the usual fashion. Suck, girl, she laughed, and she walked the short distance home. A disconcerting mixture of mud and pity was one thing, but kissing Rudy Steiner was something entirely different. Smiling sadly on the step, he called out, rummaging a hand through his hair. One day, he warned her. One day, Liesel. In the basement just over 2 years later, Liesel ached sometimes to go next door and see him, even if she was writing in the early hours of morning. She also realized it was most likely those sodden days at Hitler Youth that had fed his and subsequently her own desire for crime. After all, despite the usual bouts of rain, summer was beginning to arrive properly. The Clara apples should have been ripening. There was more stealing to be done. The losers. When it came to stealing, Liesel and Rudy first stuck with the idea that there was safety in numbers. Andy Schmeichel invited them to the river for a meeting. Among other things, a game plan for fruit stealing would be on the agenda. So are you the leader now? Rudy had asked, but Andy shook his head, heavy with disappointment. He clearly wished that he had what it took. No. His cool voice was unusually warm, half-baked. There's someone else. The new Arthur Berg. He had windy hair and cloudy eyes, and he was the kind of delinquent who had no other reason to steal except that he enjoyed it. His name was Victor Chemmel. Unlike most people engaged in the various acts of thievery, Victor Chemmel had it all. He lived in the best part of town, of Mulching, high up in a villa that had been fumigated when the Jews were driven out. He had money. He had cigarettes. What he wanted, however, was more. No crime in wanting a little more, he claimed, lying back in the grass with a collection of boys assembled around him. Wanting more is our fundamental right as Germans. What does our Freuer say? He answered his own rhetoric. We must take what is rightfully ours. At face value, Victor Chemmel was clearly your typical teenage bullshit artist. Unfortunately, when he felt like revealing it, he also possessed a certain charisma, a kind of follow me. When Liesel and Rudy approached the group by the river, she heard him ask another question. So where are these two deviants you've been bragging about? It's 4:10 already. Not by my watch, said Rudy. Victor Chemmel propped himself up on an elbow. You're not wearing a watch. Would I be here if I was rich enough to own a watch? The new leader sat up fully and smiled with straight white teeth. He then turned his casual focus onto the girl. Who's a little whore? Liesel, well accustomed to verbal abuse, simply watched the fog-ridden texture of his eyes. Last year, she listed, I stole at least 300 apples and dozens of potatoes. I have little trouble with barbed wire fences, and I can keep up with anyone here. Is that right? Yes. She did not shrink or step away. All I ask is a small part of anything we take. A dozen apples here or there. A few leftovers for me and my friend. Well, I suppose that can be arranged. Victor lit a cigarette and raised it to his mouth. He made a concerted effort to blow his next mouthful in Liesel's face. Liesel did not cough. It was the same group as the previous year, the only exception being the leader. Liesel wondered why none of the other boys had assumed the helm, but looking from face to face, she realized that none of them had it. They had no qualms about stealing, but they needed to be told. They liked to be told, and Victor Chemmel liked to be the teller. It was a nice microcosm. For a moment, Liesel longed for the reappearance of Arthur Berg. Or would he, too, have fallen under the leadership of Chemmel? It didn't matter. Liesel only knew that Arthur Berg did not have a tyrannical bone in his body, whereas the new leader had hundreds of them. Last year, she knew that if she was stuck in a tree, Arthur would come back for her, despite claiming otherwise. This year, by comparison, she was instantly aware that Victor Chemmel wouldn't even bother to look back. He stood regarding the lanky boy and the malnourished-looking girl. So you want to steal with me? What did they have to lose? They nodded. He stepped closer and grabbed Rudy's hair. I want to hear it. Definitely, Rudy said, before being shoved back, fringe first. And you? Of course. Liesel was quick enough to avoid the same treatment. Victor smiled. He squashed his cigarette, breathed deeply in, and scratched his chest. My gentleman, my whore, it looks like it's time to go shopping. As the group walked off, Liesel and Rudy were at the back, as they'd always been in the past. Do you like him? Rudy whispered. Do you? Rudy paused a moment. I think he's a complete bastard. Me too. The group was getting away from them. Come on, Rudy said. We've fallen behind. After a few miles, they reached the first farm. What greeted them was a shock. The trees, they'd imagined to be swollen with fruit, were frail and injured looking. With only a small array of apples hanging miserably up from each branch, the next farm was the same. Maybe it was a bad season, or their timing wasn't quite right. By the end of the afternoon, when the spoils were handed out, Liesl and Rudy were given one diminutive apple between them. In fairness, the takings were incredibly poor, but Victor Chemel also ran a tighter ship. "What do you call this?" Rudy asked, the apple resting in his palm. Victor didn't even turn around. "What does it look like?" The words were dropped over his shoulder. "One lousy apple? Here." A half-eaten one was also tossed their way, landing chewed side down in the dirt. "You can have that one, too." Rudy was incensed. "To hell with this. We didn't walk 10 miles for one and a half scrawny apples, did we, Liesl?" Liesl did not answer. She did not have time, for Victor Chemel was on top of Rudy before she could utter a word. His knees had pinned Rudy's arms and his hands were around his throat. The apples were scooped up by none other than Andy Schmeichel at Victor's request. "You're hurting him," Liesl said. "Am I?" Victor was smiling again. She hated that smile. "He's not hurting me." Rudy's words were rushed together and his face was red with strain. His nose began to bleed. After an extended moment or two of increased pressure, Victor let Rudy go and climbed off him, taking a few careless steps. He said, "Get up, boy," and Rudy, choosing wisely, did as he was told. Victor came casually closer again and faced him. He gave him a gentle rub on the arm, a whisper, "Unless you want me to turn that blood into a fountain, I suggest you go away, little boy." He looked at Liesl, "and take the little slut with you." No one moved. "Well, what are you waiting for?" Liesl took Rudy's hand and they left, but not before Rudy turned one last time and spat some blood and saliva at Victor Chimmel's feet. It evoked one final remark, a small threat from Victor Chemel to Rudy Steiner. "You'll pay for that at a later date, my friend." Say what you will about Victor Chemel, but he certainly had patience and a good memory. It took him approximately 5 months to turn his statement into a true one. Sketches. If the summer of 1941 was walling up around the likes of Rudy and Liesl, it was writing and painting itself in the life of Max Vandenberg. In his loneliest moments in the basement, the words started piling up around him. The visions began to pour and fall and occasionally limp from out of his hands. He had what he called just a small ration of tools, a painted book, a handful of pencils, a mind full of thoughts. Like a simple puzzle, he put them together. Originally, Max had intended to write his own story. The idea was to write about everything that had happened to him, all that had led him to a Himmel Street basement. But it was not what came out. Max's exile produced something else entirely. It was a collection of random thoughts, and he chose to embrace them. They felt true. They were more real than the letters he wrote to his family and to his friend Walter Kugler, knowing very well that he could never send them. The desecrated pages of Mein Kampf were becoming a series of sketches, page after page, which to him summed up the events that had swapped his former life for another. Some took minutes, others hours. He resolved that when the book was finished, he'd give it to Liesl when she was old enough and hopefully when all this nonsense was over. From the moment he tested the pencils on the first painted page, he kept the book close at all times. Often it was next to him or still in his fingers as he slept. One afternoon after his push-ups and sit-ups, he fell asleep against the basement wall. When Liesl came down, she found the book sitting next to him, slanted against his thigh, and curiosity got the better of her. She leaned over and picked it up, waiting for him to stir. He didn't. Max was sitting with his head and shoulder blades against the wall. She could barely make out the sound of his breath, coasting in and out of him as she opened the book and glimpsed a few random pages. Not the Freuer, the conductor. Isn't it a lovely day? Frightened by what she saw, Liesl placed the book back down, exactly as she found it, against Max's leg. A voice startled her. "Danke schön," he said, and when she looked across, following the trail of sound to its owner, a small sign of satisfaction was present on his Jewish lips. "Holy Christ," Liesl gasped. "You scared me, Max." He returned to his sleep, and behind her, the girl dragged the same thought up the steps. "You scared me, Max." The whistler and the shoes. The same pattern continued through the end of summer and well into autumn. Rudy did his best to survive the Hitler Youth. Max did his push-ups and made his sketches. Liesl found newspapers and wrote her words on the basement wall. It's also worthy of mention that every pattern has at least one small bias, and one day it will tip itself over or fall from one page to another. In this case, the dominant factor was Rudy, or at least Rudy in freshly fertilized sports field. Late in October, all appeared to be usual. A filthy boy was walking down Himmel Street. Within a few minutes, his family would expect his arrival, and he would lie that everyone in his Hitler Youth division was given extra drills in the field. His parents would even expect some laughter. They didn't get it. Today, Rudy was all out of laughter and lies. On this particular Wednesday, when Liesl looked more closely, she could see that Rudy Steiner was shirtless, and he was furious. "What happened?" she asked as he trudged past. He reversed back and held out the shirt. "Smell it," he said. "What? Are you deaf? I said smell it." Reluctantly, Lisa leaned in and caught a ghastly whiff of the brown garment. "Jesus, Mary and Joseph, is that?" The boy nodded. "It's on my chin, too. My chin. I'm lucky I didn't swallow it. Jesus, Mary and Joseph." The feel that Hitler Youth just got fertilized. He gave his shirt another half-hearted, disgusted appraisal. "It's cow manure, I think." "Did what's-his-name, Deutscher, know it was there?" "He says he didn't, but he was grinning." "Jesus, Mary, and can you stop saying that?" What Rudy needed at this point in time was a victory. He had lost in his dealings with Victor Chimmel. He'd endured problem after problem at the Hitler Youth. All he wanted was a small scrap of triumph, and he was determined to get it. He continued home, but when he reached the concrete step, he changed his mind and came slowly, purposefully back to the girl. Careful and quiet, he spoke. "You know what would cheer me up?" Liesl cringed. "If you think I'm going to, in that state..." He seemed disappointed in her. "No, not that." He sighed and stepped closer. "Something else." After a moment's thought, he raised his head just a touch. "Look at me. I'm filthy. I stink like cow shit or dog shit, whatever your opinion. And as usual, I'm absolutely starving." He paused. "I need a win, Liesl. Honestly." Liesl knew. She'd have gone closer, but for the smell of him. Stealing. They had to steal something. No, they had to steal something back. It didn't matter what. It needed only to be soon. "Just you and me this time," Rudy suggested. "No channels, no schmeagles, just you and me." The girl couldn't help it. Her hands itched, her pulse split, and her mouth smiled all at the same time. "Sounds good." "It's agreed then," and although he tried not to, Rudy could not hide the fertilized grin that grew on his face. "Tomorrow?" Liesl nodded. "Tomorrow." Their plan was perfect, but for one thing. They had no idea where to start. Fruit was out. Rudy snubbed his nose at onions and potatoes, and they drew the line at another attempt on Otto Sturm and his bike full of farm produce. Once was immoral, twice was completely bastardry. "So where the hell do we go?" Rudy asked. "How should I know? This was your idea, wasn't it?" That doesn't mean you shouldn't think a little, too. I can't think of everything. You can barely think of anything." They argued on as they walked through town. On the outskirts, they witnessed the first of the farms and the trees standing like emaciated statues. The branches were gray, and when they looked up at them, there was nothing but ragged limbs and empty sky. Rudy spat. They walked back through mulching, making suggestions. "What about Freud Diller? What about her? Maybe if we say Heil Hitler and then steal something, we'll be all right." After roaming Munich Street for an hour or so, the daylight was drawing to a close and they were on the verge of giving up. "It's pointless," Rudy said, "and I'm even hungrier now than I've ever been. I'm starving, for Christ's sake." He walked another dozen steps before he stopped and looked back. "What's with you?" Because now Liesl was standing completely still and a moment of realization was strapped to her face. Why hadn't she thought of it before? "What is it?" Rudy was becoming impatient. "Sament, what's going on?" At that very moment, Liesl was presented with a decision. Could she truly carry out what she was thinking? Could she really seek revenge on a person like this? Could she despise someone this much? She began walking in the opposite direction. When Rudy caught up, she slowed a little in the vain hope of achieving a little more clarity. After all, the guilt was already there. It was moist. The seed was already bursting into a dark leaf flower. She weighed up whether she could really go through with this. At a crossroads, she stopped. "I know a place." They went over the river and made their way up the hill. On Grand Strasse, they took in the splendor of the houses. The front doors glowed with polish, and the roof tiles sat like toupees, combed to perfection. The walls and windows were manicured, and the chimneys almost breathed out smoke rings. Rudy planted his feet. "The mayor's house?" Liesl nodded seriously. A pause. "They fired my mama." When they angled toward it, Rudy asked just how, in God's name, they were going to get inside. But Liesl knew. "Local knowledge," she answered. "Local." But when they were able to see the windows of the library at the far end of the house, she was greeted with a shock. The window was closed. "Well?" Rudy asked. Liesl swiveled slowly and hurried off. "Not today," she said. Rudy laughed. "I knew it," he caught up. "I knew it. You filthy sawmensch, you couldn't get in there even if you had the key. Do you mind?" She quickened even more and brushed aside Rudy's commentary. "We just have to wait for the right opportunity." Internally, she shrugged away from a kind of gladness that the window was closed. She berated herself. "Why, Liesl?" she asked. "Why did you have to explode when they fired Mama? Why couldn't you just keep your big mouth shut? For all you know, the mayor's wife is now completely reformed after you yelled and screamed at her. Maybe she straightened herself out, picked herself up. Maybe she'll never let herself shiver in that house again and the window will be shut forever. You stupid sawmensch." A week later, however, on their fifth visit to the upper part of the mulching, it was there. The open window breathed a slice of air in. That was all it would take. It was Rudy who stopped first. He tapped Liesl on the ribs with the back of his hand. "Is that window," he whispered, "open?" The eagerness in his voice leaned from his mouth like a forearm onto Liesl's shoulder. "Joel," she answered. "It sure is." and how her heart began to heat. On each previous occasion, when they found the window clamped firmly shut, Liesl's outer disappointment had masked a ferocious relief. Would she have had the neck to go in? And who and what, in fact, was she going in for? For Rudy? To locate some food? No, the repugnant truth was this. She didn't care about the food. Rudy, no matter how hard she tried to resist the idea, was secondary to her plan. It was the book she wanted, the Whistler. She wouldn't tolerate having it given to her by a lonely, pathetic old woman. Stealing it, on the other hand, seemed a little more acceptable. Stealing it, in a sick kind of sense, was like earning it. The light was changing in blocks of shade. The pair of them gravitated toward the immaculate, bulky house. They rustled their thoughts. You hungry? Rudy asked. Liesl replied, starving, for a book. Look, a light just came on upstairs. I see it. Still hungry, Salmensch? They laughed nervously for a moment before going through the motions of who should go in and who should stand watch. As the male in the operation, Rudy clearly felt that he should be the aggressor, but it was obvious that Liesl knew this place. It was she who was going in. She knew what was on the other side of the window. She said it. It has to be me. Liesl closed her eyes tightly. She compelled herself to remember, to see visions of the mayor and his wife. She watched her gathered friendship with Ilsa Herman and made sure to see it kicked in the shins and left by the wayside. It worked. She detested them. They scouted the streets and crossed the yard silently. Now they were crouched beneath the slit in the window on the ground floor. The sound of their breathing amplified. Here, Rudy said, give me your shoes. You'll be quieter. Without complaint, Liesl undid the worn black laces and left the shoes on the ground. She rose up and Rudy gently opened the window just wide enough for Liesl to climb through. The noise of it passed overhead like a low-flying plane. Liesl heaved herself onto the ledge and tussled her way inside, taking off her shoes. She realized it was a brilliant idea as she landed much heavier on the wooden floor than she anticipated. The soles of her feet expanded in that painful way, rising to the inside edges of her socks. The room itself was as it always was. Liesl, in the dusty dimness, shrugged off her feelings of nostalgia. She crept forward and allowed her eyes to adjust. What's going on? Rudy whispered sharply from outside, but she waved him a backhander that meant, halt small, keep quiet. The food, he reminded her. Find the food, and cigarettes if you can. Both items, however, were the last things on her mind. She was home, among the mayor's books of every color and description, with their silver and gold lettering. She could smell the pages. She could almost taste the words as they stacked up around her. Her feet took her to the right-hand wall. She knew the one she wanted, the exact position, but when she made to the Whistler's usual place on the shelf, it was not there. A slight gap was in its place. From above, she heard footsteps. The light, Rudy whispered. The words were shoved through the open window. It's out! Scheiße! They're coming downstairs! It was a giant length of a moment. Then, the eternity of split-second decision. Her eyes scanned the room, and she could see the Whistler sitting patiently on the mayor's desk. Hurry up, Rudy warned her. But very calmly and cleanly, Liesl walked over, picked up the book, and made her way cautiously out. Head first, she climbed from the window, managing to land on her feet again, feeling the pang of pain once more, this time in her ankles. Come on, Rudy implored her. Run! Run, schnell! Once around the corner on the road back down to the river in Munich Street, she stopped to bend over and recover. Her body was folded in the middle, the air half frozen in her mouth, her heart tolling in her ears. Rudy was the same. When he looked over, he saw the book under her arm. He struggled to speak. What's... He grappled with the words. With the book. The darkness was filling up truly now. Liesl panted, the air in her throat defrosting. It was all I could find. Unfortunately, Rudy could smell it. The lie. He cocked his head and told her what he felt was a fact. You didn't go in for food, did you? You got what you wanted. Liesl straightened then and was overcome with the sickness of another realization. The shoes. She looked at Rudy's feet, then at his hands, and at the ground all around him. What? He asked. What is it? Sakul, she accused him. Where are my shoes? Rudy's face was whitened, which left her in no doubt. They're back at the house, she suggested, aren't they? Rudy searched desperately around him, begging against all reality that he might have brought them with him. He imagined himself picking them up, wishing it true, but the shoes were not there. They sat uselessly, or actually much worse, incriminatingly, by the wall at 8 Grand Strasse. Don't come, he admonished himself, smacking his ear. He looked down shamefully at the sullen sight of Liesl's socks. Idiot! It didn't take him long to decide on making it right. Earnestly, he said, just wait, and he hurried back around the corner. Don't get caught, Liesl called after him, but he didn't hear. The minutes were heavy while he was gone. Darkness was now complete, and Liesl was quite certain that Avastin was most likely in the cards when she returned home. Hurry, she murmured, but still Rudy didn't appear. She imagined the sound of police siren throwing itself forward and reeling itself in, collecting itself. Still nothing. Only when she walked back to the intersection of the two streets in her damp, dirty socks did she see him. Rudy's triumphant face was held nicely up as he trotted steadily toward her. His teeth were gnashed into a grin and the shoes dangled from his hand. They nearly killed me, he said, but I made it. Once they'd crossed the river, he handed Liesl the shoes and she threw them down. Sitting on the ground, she looked up at her best friend. Danke, she said. Thank you. Rudy bowed. My pleasure. He tried for a little more. No point asking if I'd get a kiss for that, I guess. For bringing my shoes, which you left behind? Fair enough. He held up his hands and continued speaking as they walked on, and Liesl made a concerted effort to ignore him. She only heard the last part. Probably wouldn't want to kiss you anyway, not if your breath's anything like your shoes. You disgust me, she informed him, and she hoped he couldn't see the escape beginnings of a smile that had fallen from her mouth. On Himmel Street, Rudy captured the book. Under a lamppost, he read out the title and wondered what it was about. Dreamily, Liesl answered, just a murderer. Is that all? There's also a policeman trying to catch him. Rudy handed it back. Speaking of which, I think we're both slightly in for it when we get home. You especially. Why me? You know, your mama. What about her? Liesl was exercising the blatant right of every person who's ever belonged to a family. It's all very well for such a person to whine and moan and criticize other family members, but they won't let anyone else do it. That's when you get your back up and show loyalty. Is there something wrong with her? Rudy backed away. Sorry, Samench. I didn't mean to offend you. Even in the night, Liesl could see that Rudy was growing. His face was lengthening. The blonde shock of hair was darkening ever so slightly, and his features seemed to be changing shape. But there was one thing that would never change. It was impossible to be angry at him for long. Anything good to eat at your place tonight? He asked. I doubt it. Me neither. It's a shame you can't eat books. Arthur Berg said something like that once, remember? They recounted the good old days for the remainder of the walk, Liesl often glancing down at the Whistler, at the gray cover and the black imprinted title. Before they went into their respective homes, Rudy stopped a moment and said, goodbye, Samench. He laughed. Good night, book thief. It was the first time Liesl had been branded with her title, and she couldn't hide the fact that she liked it very much. As we're both aware, she'd stolen books previously, but in late October 1941, it became official. That night, Liesl Memminger truly became the book thief.